What is going on YouTube? It's your boy Spanko, and today I'm excited because I'm bringing you guys a deck that I haven't done on the channel since maybe when I first started the channel. It was one of the first deck profiles I did, and I just haven't done it since, and that is For Hire. Now, For Hire is like super rogue, but it is 2022, it is the new year, and you know what? I thought to myself, let's do a how to play For Hires in 2022 in this format for today's video. Now, if you guys do enjoy this video, make sure to like the video and subscribe to the channel for more Yu-Gi-Oh! Content. Thank you guys all for supporting me throughout the journey. I appreciate every single one of you. 2022 is going to be a great year for the channel. And with that, let's get into the video. Okay, so just before we get started, I do want to say that I truly believe the best way to play For Hire in 2022 in today's format is to go second, break boards, and OTK your opponent, all right? I just wanted to say that from the jump, and now let's get into the profile. We are starting off with Triple Beat Bladesman For Hire. Now, if you guys don't know this deck, and if you guys are new to this deck, let me explain some of their effects for you guys. All the baby For Hires, and by baby, I mean all the normal summonable ones, have the same effect where during your main phase, you can special summon a For Hire card from your hand that's not the same name. So Beat can't summon a Beat, but Beat can summon any other one, right? Your Bravo can't summon another Bravo, but Bravo can summon any other For Hire, if that makes sense. Okay, so they all share that exact same effect, so all your For Hires will have that effect. Each one also has its own unique effect, which I'm going to get into. So we are playing Triple Beat. Beat searches one when you summon another For Hire monster, and that's really important. Of course, it's a rota for the deck, so you are playing Beat. Then you have Triple Bravo. Bravo actually doesn't have one of the better effects. It's actually one of the worst effects, to be honest with you, where if another one is special summoned, your For Hire monsters can gain 500 attack. It's not that important because usually you're using your For Hire monsters to link climb anyways, but the reason you want to play Bravo specifically is because it's the biggest attack normal summonable one. So that's really important when it comes to, you know, attacking over something like a barrier statue, or that's really important when it comes to attacking over something like a fossil Dyna. There's a lot of situations where Bravo is just very important, just it being the bigger one. Also helps you OTK sometimes with like something like Borosaur Dragon. 1900 helps you OTK. So that's why you're playing three Bravo, but mostly you're just playing it for the name. Then you have Seal. Seal can pretty much target a monster in your graveyard and then add it back to your hand. You have double Helmer. Helmer is really good because you can discard it For Hire to draw a card, so it kind of fixes your hand. It also works really well with Seal because that card you discard, you can add back with your Seal. So that's why Helmer is really good. Then you're playing double Donpa as well as double Recon. Recon pops set cards your opponent controls. Keep in mind, set means back row, but it also means set monsters that can come up as well. And then you have Donpa, which pops face up cards. Okay, so this helps you essentially break your opponent's boards. And then you're playing double Philo. Philo is really good. It special summons from your graveyard when you summon another For Hire. So that's all their effects, but again, you have to keep in mind that all their effects have the same one, where it's during your main phase, special summon one from your hand. Okay, so that's all the baby For Hires. Now the big For Hires, we're playing double Raphael as well as one Dyna. So Raphael, I think the name is Rafale or Rafael, I don't even know what the name is. I just like to call it Raphael. I think it's cool. So Raphael, this one's really good because essentially on the board, he's a monster negate. You can discard a For Hire card when your opponent activates a monster effect to negate it. But the other effect is when he's special summoned, you can excavate cards from the top of your deck up to the number of different named For Hire monsters on your side of the field. Add one of the cards to your hand and then put the rest of the bottom of your deck. Kind of helps you add cards to your hand. Again, the big ones don't have the effect to special summon. So if you are ever summoning these ones, you want to summon them last, right? And then you're playing one Dyna. Dyna is really good because he's kind of like a DD Crow essentially. When he's special summoned, you can banish cards from your opponent's graveyard up to the number of For Hire monsters you control. That's really good because a lot of cards and a lot of decks in today's format do rely on their graveyard to a certain extent. So if you can just summon Dyna, and even if you're only banishing like one or two or three sometimes, depending on how many For Hires you have, that could be devastating for your opponent. So Dyna is really good. Also keep in mind that Raphael is 28 and Dyna is 25. So these are pretty big monsters to help you OTK as well. Now for the cards that actually help you OTK and help you break boards, you are playing triple Kaiju, triple Gamma Seal, okay? But the reason I say triple Kaiju is because essentially Gamma Seal could be any other Kaiju. It could be Ghidorla, just in case you're afraid of like barrier statue. It could be any Kaiju in general, okay? Now I will say this, and I know I'm gonna get this question asked in the comments, or I might not get it because I'm explaining it now, but essentially the reason you want to play Gamma Seal over something like Alpha, a lot of people like to play or like to ask me, hey, why don't you play Alpha? Because specifically it's a beast, it works in these kind of decks. That doesn't really matter too much. The reason you don't want to play Alpha is because the effect is not always gonna go off. Yes, it's a cool special summon, don't get me wrong, but it's a bounce. And the problem with alpha is that if your opponent sets up negates, the alpha is most of the time not going to go through, or you're going to have to waste your battle phase, special summon the alpha, attack over it, and then use alpha effect and then keep going, right? The reason that's not good for you is because you want to OTK your opponent, and summoning the alpha and using your battle phase means you're not going to be OTKing your opponent. So that's why I like the Gamma Seal as well as the Pankatrops as well. Pank is a pop. It's really powerful. Of course, we all know how strong Pank is. Gamma Seal is really, really good, or any Kaiju really is really, really good because it outs anything in today's format. If you think DPE is very popular in today's format, you have cards like Dragoon that you can just instantly out with a Gamma Seal. You have cards like Apex Avion, which is important with Tri-Brigade. You have cards like F-Zero also, which is important with Tri-Brigade. Even the Sky Striker matchup, Gamma Sealing them essentially shuts off their back row because they'll have a monster in their main monster zone. So Kaijus are really, really good this format. And in any going second deck that needs to break boards, Kaijus are the way to go. That's why I like triple Gamma Seal. One Pank, of course, like I said. And then you do want to be playing a lot of extenders in this deck. Of course, all the monsters special summon each other out, so they kind of extend in that sense. But you want to play even further because sometimes you don't always draw into like a Kaiju. You don't always draw into like multiple board breaking cards. So what you need to do and what you need to be able to do to be competitively viable is you need to be able to push through negates. A lot of the time your opponent is going to be putting up negates and disruptions, and you need to be able to push through them even if you don't open a Gamma Seal and other board breakers. So for that reason, we are playing double Mayhem for Hire, which is pretty much a Monster Reborn for Hire cards, and one Monster Reborn. So you're essentially playing three Monsters Reborns in this deck. Then we're playing one Rota. Rota essentially only searches the beat, but it's really important to still play it because beat is your best normal summon, really, because it gets you to any other for Hire from your deck. So that's why you're playing the Rota. Also, if your opponent does happen to have a negate and they negate your Rota, or like they ash the Rota, then now that's one less disruption that you have to play through. So one Rota. Now, this card is not necessary, but I will explain it real quick here. We are playing triple Pot of Prosperity. Now, this card is really, really good in this deck for a couple of reasons, but it also has this one detriment and this one anti-synergy, I should say, which is if you activate Prosperity, your opponent takes half damage for the rest of the turn. So essentially, it makes it a little bit harder to OTK. But I still recommend playing this. If you guys don't have this, because I understand it's an expensive card, if you guys don't have access to Prosperity, it's okay. You can cut it, maybe play a Called by the Grave or something like that. But you definitely, if you can, play this card, because essentially what this card does is you're playing a rogue deck at the end of the day, right? And what this card does for you is sometimes if you open four for higher monsters and your opponent has like even a single monster negate, right? Let's say a single monster negate. If you normal summon a beat and you activate beat to special summon one from your hand, and they just negate that beat, your turn is done, right? What Prosperity does for you is it helps you play through those kind of things because you can Prosperity first. One, it'll either bait out a negate, or two, it can get you into something like a Gamma Seal, or it can get you into this next card over here that we're talking about is Lightning Storm, which is gonna help you break your opponent's board, and then you can push for damage. Even if you don't OTK, you can break a board at least and then set up some kind of board yourself. This deck actually doesn't have a bad going first play either. So if you break a board, you can also kind of still make a board with this deck, which I'll get into a little bit later. But that's why I like to play Prosperity here, is because what Prosperity does is it fixes a lot of these situations where you're like, I just need one more thing to beat my opponent. Even though I can't OTK him, I just need one more thing to break this board, and then I just continue on from there. So I like to play Prosperity for that reason. But of course, if you don't want to play this, you can cut it completely. We are playing a 43 card main deck, as you guys can see here. So if you cut it, it just becomes 40. I like to play 43. I'll get into that a little bit later. But yeah, if you guys don't have this, cut it completely, add a Called by the Grave, and play 41 cards. Again, play 41, play more than 40, and I'll explain why in a second. You guys probably already know why, but I'll explain it in a second. Then, like I talked about earlier, you can play Lightning Storm. Lightning Storm is really good. One of the best board breakers in the game and really important in this deck. Now, specifically, the reason for the Lightning Storm over something like Evenly Matched is, like I said, you do want to OTK, you do want to push for damage with this deck, and Evenly Matched eats up your battle phase, which is why essentially you don't want to play Evenly Matched, so you're playing Lightning Storm. Now, Lightning Storm and Gamma Seal hand in hand are so, so powerful, because a lot of time, if you think about like the Tri-Brigade Bird Up matchup, okay, so they'll like to set up an F-Zero, but they'll also set up something like an Avion. So what ends up happening is Avion's an Omni Negate, whereas F-Zero is like a Monster Negate. So if you think about the Lightning Storm, it's most of the time gonna get negated by the Omni Negate. But if you open a Kaiju with it, you just Kaiju the Omni Negate, Lightning Storm the rest of the board. So that's why Lightning Storm and Gamma Seal are really good, or just Lightning Storm and any Kaiju are just really good hand in hand, because they just help you push through pretty much any single board, right? So three Lightning Storms. Then you're playing triple Imperm as well as triple Chalice. Essentially, I want to say one thing about Imperm, and I think this card is specifically in this deck is better just going second. So what I mean by that is, sometimes, yes, your opponent will normal summon a card and activate the effect, and if you Imperm, they'll just pass their turn. If we're talking about like a Sword Soul player who doesn't open a great hand, they normal summon one of their Sword Soul monsters, they want to get a token, you Imperm the monster, they can't get a token, they just pass, right? Yes, it happens sometimes. However, I will say that a lot of the time in today's format, if you're going against Tri Brigade, if you're going against a lot of decks, just any deck really in today's format, they can play through a single Imperm, okay? So because they can play through a single Imperm, I actually like to hold this card. And the reason I like to hold this card is because if your opponent makes a negate, right? Let's say they make a Baron, or they make, or they make an F-Zero, or they make an Avion, or they make any negate, right? They make any Omni negate, any monster negate, etc., etc. You can just hold this card until they make that negate. Then when it comes to your turn, you can just activate the Imperm and negate that card. So I like to actually hold Imperm for my turn a lot of the times with this deck, because unless I see a situation where the Imperm will stop their turn completely, then I'll just rather hold it. Also, the reason we're not playing hand traps in this deck, even though we want to go second, is because if you draw Imperm as your sixth card, it's usable. You can Imperm, you can Chalice as your sixth card, break your opponent's board, negate their effects, and then you're going from there, right? That's why you don't want to play hand traps, because if you draw like an Ash as your sixth card or a Veiler as your sixth card, it's not doing anything for you. So Imperm and Chalice, they pretty much have the same exact effect where you're just trying to negate a monster, right? And then we are playing one Red Eyes, one Dark Magician, as well as one Red Eyes Fusion. We are playing Dragoon. This is essentially the reason why I like to play more than 40 cards in the deck, because you don't want to draw the Red Eyes or the Dark Magician ever. So that's why I'm playing 43. But again, if you don't have the Prosperities, cut them, play Called by the Grave, and at least you're playing 41 cards and you have less chance of drawing these, okay? Because you don't want to draw them. Now, as you guys can see also here, we have a DPE engine. This is because you can swap the DPE engine and the Dragoon engine for this deck. Like, you can play Dragoon if you have the Dragoon engine. If you don't have the Dragoon engine, you can play the DPE engine. It works either way, but I do recommend playing one of these engines. For one reason, because you can make Verte really easily in this deck. But the reason I chose to go with Dragoon, and I want to show you guys most optimally, you guys do want to play Dragoon. You guys can play DPE though. If you guys have this one and you don't have this one, you can play DPE, okay? I just want to reiterate that. But the reason I chose Dragoon is because Dragoon is a little bit better going second. So on, like, during your main phase, after you make your Dragoon, you can pop cards your opponent controls, which helps break your boards, which is also kind of why Dragoon is a little bit better going second for this deck, because you break a board and then you do more damage with Dragoon. So that's why Dragoon is really, really important and really, really good. But I will say that DPE also has its benefits in the sense of going first. A lot of the time you're gonna be making Verte as well as IP Mascarena. And if you end up going first or you're forced to go first, DPE is a pretty good card going first, of course, right? So if you wanna play this engine, you can. I still think the Dragoon engine is a little bit better because going second is just a lot stronger and it helps you push for damage a little bit more. So that's why I like the Dragoon package, but the DPE package is just as good. So you can play one or the other, but I chose to go with the Dragoon package. For this deck specifically, I think Dragoon's a little bit better. Then we're playing one Verte as well as one IP. Now, I said earlier in the video that this deck has a really good going second, of course, but it can actually go first pretty well, because a lot of time you'll have enough for higher monsters to just make Verte and IP, and then with Verte, you can make a Dragoon, or if you're playing DPE, you can make DPE. And then on your opponent's turn, you can use IP Mascarena with Verte to just make an Apollo. So essentially now you're ending on Apollo negates, plus a Dragoon or plus a DPE, right? So that's why going first, this deck doesn't struggle too bad actually going first. You still want to go second, of course, but if you're forced to go first, it's not that bad. So yeah, Verte, IP. Then we're playing one Pentastag, helps you OTK. Then you're playing a bunch of toolbox cards. You have Nightmare Phoenix, Nightmare Cerberus, Unicorn, of course. You can go into this with IP as well. One Folgo. Folgo is pretty cool, but the problem with Folgo is he actually doesn't really help you do what this deck does anymore. This card can come up here and there. Doesn't come up too often, so that's why we're playing just the one of. Then we're playing one Trisbana as well as one Zeraboros. Specifically, we're playing these cards because we are playing one Boral Code Dragon. Now, in this deck specifically, Boral Code Dragon is such an insane card. Then you're playing one Shureg. Shureg is pretty good to make because it is non-targeting removal as well. On top of that, it only needs Beast, Beast Warrior, or Wing Beast to make it. Essentially, a lot of your monsters here, like your Seal is a Beast Warrior, Dompa as well as your Recon are both Beasts, your Philo is a Wing Beast. So you guys can make Shureg here as well. Then you're playing one Apollo, like I said earlier, with the IP and the Verte. When you're forced to go first, or if you can't OTK your opponent and you end on the IP Verte, you most of the time are going to be going into Apollo for two negates. One Axis Toad to help you OTK, as well as one Boral Sword. So this is the thing about this deck, and this is how I truly believe you should be playing for higher in 2022 in today's format, because you can break boards. And essentially, these Link monsters is what gives this deck so much potential on being able to compete, because at the end of the day, yes, it's a rogue deck, but these Link monsters give so much potential to just OTK, and with cards like Lightning Storm and Gamma Seal, you can break pretty much any board in today's format. So I think this deck is really, really cool, really, really underrated, and I'm happy to be bringing it to you guys again, honestly. So that is it for today's video. I hope you guys did enjoy. I do want to say that this is a very underrepresented deck here on YouTube, so I'm happy I could be bringing you guys these rogue decks. It's gonna be a lot of rogue, a lot of meta on the channel coming soon. 2022 is gonna be a big year for us. But I do want to say, if you guys have any suggestions, any ideas, any thoughts, let me know in the comment section down below. I love when we get better together as a community. Thank you guys all for watching. Make sure to subscribe if you haven't already. And with that, Spanko, signing out. Peace. Get up, we want you to get on your feet.